Hello friends, let us now learn some important points about benign prostatic hyperplasia. So if you see benign prostatic hyperplasia, it is age related endocrine controlled multifactorial process. It is age related endocrine controlled multifactorial process. What is the most common site of benign prostatic hyperplasia? The transition zone is the most common site of benign prostatic hyperplasia. It is age related, number one. If it is age related, if you see the incidence of benign prostatic hyperplasia in the age group of 41 to 50 years is just 20%, and the incidence in the age group of 51 to 60 years is 50%, and the incidence of age group more than 80 years is 90%. Then if you see the endocrine control, actually this benign prostatic hyperplasia production is under the control of testosterone. It is under the control of testosterone. Then if you see in the cut section, in the transverse section or cut section of benign prostatic hyperplasia, you will see that there will be epithelium, there will be stroma. This stroma is actually composed of collagen and smooth muscles. You will have epithelium and stroma composed of collagen and smooth muscles. And it also has rich adrenergic nerve endings. It has rich adrenergic nerve endings also. Now if you see now what are the secondary changes which are seen in bladder? Secondary changes in the bladder in benign prostatic hyperplasia. If you see these, they are mainly seen due to, first, because of benign prostatic hyperplasia, there is increased collagen deposition. Number one, there is increased collagen deposition. There is detrusor, smooth muscle hyperplasia. There is increased collagen deposition. There is detrusor, smooth muscle hyperplasia is seen, and you will also see presence of detrusor muscle hypertrophy is seen. Okay, because of detrusor hyperplasia and hypertrophy, so these will result in irritate the bladder, and thus it will result in symptoms of frequency, urgency and nocturia are seen. So these are the secondary changes in the bladder. Now what about the clinical features? So if you see the clinical features of the bladder, the clinical features of benign prostatic hyperplasia can be divided into two types. One, it is irritative features. Second are obstructive features. Because of the irritative features, there will be frequency, urgency, and you will see nocturia. Then because of obstructive features, there will be poor flow. Because now this prostate is obstructing the bladder flow. Right, bladder outflow. So there will be poor flow or poor stream will be seen, and you will see hesitancy is seen. Poor flow or poor stream, hesitancy, intermittency, and there is also incomplete evacuation of the bladder. Okay, and you will also see presence of dribbling of urine. And you will also see post-residual volume. You will see dribbling of urine and you see post-residual volume. So these are the clinical features of benign prostatic hyperplasia. Now, if you see the investigations, in the investigations, first we do uroflowmetry is done. Uroflowmetry is mainly done to document the infection. Uroflowmetry is done to document the obstruction, not infection, sorry, obstruction. It is done to document the obstruction. Normally, if uroflowmetry is done normally, the Q max will be more than 15 milliliters per second. Okay, uroflowmetry is mainly done to document the infection. Normal uroflowmetry, if Q max is more than 15 milliliters per second, then uroflowmetry is said to be equivocal. If Q max is 10 to 15 milliliters per second, Q max is residual urine. It is the flow. The amount of urine which is flown in 1 second. That means if more than 15 ml of urine is flown in 1 second, that means if the person has maturated more than 15 ml of urine in 1 second, then the flow maximum is normal. If the person has maturated only 10 to 15 ml of urine, then it is equivocal. That is, if urinary flow is 10 to 15 ml per second, then it is equivocal. If the urinary flow or Q max is less than 10 milliliters per second, then it is suggestive of obstruction. That is uroflowmetry. Then second, we can also do cystometry. This cystometry is mainly done to confirm the diagnosis. So if you see in the cystometry, we have voiding pressure is the one which we calculate in cystometry. That is the pressure with which the person micturates. If the voiding pressure is more than 80 centimeters of water, then it is diagnostic of obstruction. So in benign prostatic hyperplasia, if you see the diagnostic criteria, the diagnostic criteria of benign prostatic hyperplasia are two. One, it is the if the voiding pressure is being more than 80 centimeters of water, and Q max or flow rate is less than 10 ml per second. So that is diagnostic of benign prostatic hyperplasia. Now we have one scoring system for benign prostatic hyperplasia, which is called as International Prostate Symptom Score. We have International Prostate Symptom Score. In International Prostate Symptom Score, the score will vary from 0 to 35. The score is said to be mild if it is 0 to 7. It is said to be moderate. The score is said to be mild if it is 0 to 7. It is said to be moderate if it is 8 to 19. Then the score is said to be severe if it is 20 to 35. Okay. Then, in the investigations, if you do digital rectal examination, on digital rectal examination, you will see smooth enlargement of prostate is seen. Then, if you see the management, you can give alpha blockers are actually preferred. Alpha blockers, like we can give prazosin, terazosin, doxazosin, alfuzosin, and cildosin are given. But what is the most commonly used is tamsulosin is most commonly used, because this is selective alpha 1A inhibitor. Okay, then if these are the first line agents, then what about the second line agents? Second line agents which are used include, we can use 5-alpha reductase inhibitors. These are 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, which include finasteride, dutasteride. These include finasteride, dutasteride, and ट्रिप्टोरेलिन पामो एट right. So these alpha blockers, what do they do? These alpha blockers will cause relaxation of muscles, smooth muscles. They will be useful in smooth muscle predominant state. Generally we will not see these differences clinically. We generally give both these or any one of these based on the patient, but if the smooth muscle is predominant, this will be more useful. Okay, then 5-alpha reductase is inhibitors. These are given usually if epithelial component is predominant. If we give them, there will be better results. But how will we differentiate it? It is difficult to differentiate it, right? So we give any of these based on the requirement. So if you see, these alpha blockers are actually active instantly. So these are the preferred ones. But if you see these 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, the minimum time for them to act is around 1 month is required to act, and maximum effect is seen after 6 months of usage of these agents. For continuous 6 months, then you see maximum effect. So mostly we prefer alpha blockers when compared to 5-alpha reductase. Okay, then combination treatment can also be given. Combination treatment, that is alpha blockers plus 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, both these can be combined in patients with large prostate or if the patient has high prostate specific antigen levels. Okay, in these patients you can give combination of both of these. Then what are the indications of surgery intervention? When do you do surgery? Indications of surgical intervention, if you see, if there is no improvement on medical therapy. Number one, if there is no improvement after medical management, or if there is recurrent UTI, or if there is renal failure, or if the patient has bladder stones. Recurrent UTI, renal failure, or bladder stones are present in the patient. If the patient presents with cross hematuria, or if the patient presents with refractory urinary retention, in these cases the surgical intervention should be done. What is the surgical treatment? What is the surgery which you do? The gold standard surgery which we do is gold standard surgery. If you see, this is transurethral resection of prostate. Transurethral resection of prostate is the gold standard surgical technique. Okay, now let us learn some important points about transurethral resection of prostate. So in transurethral resection of prostate, first, the technique used is, there are two techniques which can be used. One, we have Nesbitt technique. First technique is Nesbitt technique. This Nesbitt technique is most preferred. The second technique which we can use is Mohr-Mayer technique. This Mohr-Mayer technique can also be used. Then for irrigation we can use 1.5% glycine can be used. Then if transurethral resection is done in monopolar cautery, then electrolytes, if we have done it in monopolar cautery, electrolyte like normal saline should not be used. Electrolytes like normal saline should not be used, because here in this if we use normal saline, then the ion dissipates the current, ions will dissipate the current locally. So because it this local current dissipation will result in local damage, so we do not use normal saline in monopolar cautery. But if you see in bipolar cautery, normal saline can be used as an irrigation fluid. Normal saline is used. If bipolar cautery is used and normal saline is used, then we call it as TURIS. What is TURIS? Presents doing transurethral resection of prostate in saline, then we call it as TURIS. Then if you were asked one liner, what is the most important landmarks? Okay. What is the landmarks? What is the most important proximal, not proximal, sorry, distal. Distal landmark in the, what is the most important distal landmark in TURP? Then it is verumontanum. Verumontanum is the most common distal landmark in the TURP. This verumontanum is actually located proximally. It is located proximally to external urethral sphincter. So this verumontanum is the most important landmark. So what about distally? That is distally. Then what about proximally? If you see proximally, there is no landmark. Because there is no landmark, there is high risk of injury to internal urethral sphincter occurs in the TURP surgery. In the transurethral resection of prostate, there is high risk of injury to internal urethral sphincter occurs. Okay, what do you do here? Here we will first, if this is the bladder and this is the prostate, through the urethra you will pass an endoscope and you will remove the tissue of bladder through transurethral route. Okay, now what about the complications? The complications which are used in which can occur in TURP include, complications most commonly include, these can result in retrograde ejaculation. Most common complication is retrograde ejaculation in almost 75% of cases. There can be incontinence, can be seen in 10% of, incontinence can be seen in less than 1% of case. Impotence will occur in 10% of cases. Why is this retrograde ejaculation? This is This retrograde ejaculation is due to the injury to the internal urethral sphincter. Okay, then if you were asked what are the late complications, you will also see late complications like relaxation. You will see bladder neck stenosis is seen. Bladder neck stenosis is seen in 4% of the cases, and you will also see urethral stricture. Okay, bladder neck stenosis and urethral stricture is seen in 3.6% of cases. You will see urethral stricture. Okay, next, these are the late complications. Next, one more complication which is seen here is, which is important, is called as TURS syndrome. What is this TURS syndrome? In TURS syndrome, which is also called as water intoxication syndrome, or we can also call it as dilutional hyponatremia. So what do you see in this TURS syndrome? The predisposing factors of TURS syndrome mainly includes the size of the prostate. It occurs when the size of the prostate is more than 75 grams and if the duration of surgery is more than 90 minutes. So what are the clinical features? Here, why does this TURS syndrome occurs is because we will constantly irrigate the bladder. So while irrigating the bladder with either glycine or any other solute, this will result in water can enter the system, enter the intravascular system, leading to water intoxication, leading to the following symptoms. And this will result in high, because of increased water than the solute, so this results in decreased sodium. So that is hyponatremia. Now the symptoms are due to decreased sodium. Whenever sodium is decreased, you will see clinical features like there will be dizziness, you will see confusion, dizziness, fluid overload is seen. Okay, dizziness, confusion, fluid overload, and you will also see visual abnormalities are seen. Then you will see presence of bradycardia. Then you will see hypertension. So these are the clinical features which you see with TUR syndrome. Then the treatment of TUR syndrome. Once you see TUR syndrome, you will have to decrease this volume overload. So this volume overload, in order to decrease it, the drug of choice is furosemide is given to decrease the volume overload. If there is no response to furosemide, then you can give 3% normal saline can be you given. This 3% normal saline is a hypertonic saline. Okay, so this is about the TUR syndrome. Then, so this is about the transurethral resection of prostate. Then the next type of resection is, we can also resect the enlarged prostate by giving an incision, transurethral incision of prostate. There is transurethral incision of prostate can be done, TUIP this is. In transurethral incision of the prostate, Collins knife is used. Here in transurethral incision of prostate, Collins knife is used, and you can put two incisions can be put at 5 o'clock position, one at 5 o'clock position and the other at 7 o'clock position. You can put two incisions can be put, one at 5 o'clock position and the other at 7 o'clock position. Then if you see advantages, prostate up to almost 20 grams can be resected without any complications. Okay, this is called as transurethral incision of prostate. One advantage is there is no side effects like retrograde ejaculation. There is no retrograde ejaculation and there is also no impotence. So these two side effects which are seen in transurethral resection of prostate are absent for this transurethral incision of prostate. Then the next important thing if you see is open prostatectomy. So in open prostatectomy, if you see the indications of open prostatectomy include size of the prostate. If the size of the prostate is more than 75 grams, the open prostatectomy can also be done if there is bladder stone. Or it can also be done in bladder diverticula. In bladder stone, bladder diverticula, or if the size of the prostate is more than 75 grams, then you can see open prostatectomy can be done. Now, if you see the named prostatectomies, named procedures. Named procedures are, one, we have Freyer's suprapubic prostatectomy. In Freyer's suprapubic prostatectomy, this is mainly done in patients with bladder stone and bladder diverticulum, because here we are entering the prostate through the bladder. So if there is bladder stone and bladder diverticulum, we can do this Freyer's suprapubic prostatectomy. Then second, we have Millen's retropubic prostatectomy. This is Millen's retropubic prostatectomy. Then the next important type is around Young's. We have Young's perineal prostatectomy. This Young's perineal prostatectomy is almost obsolete type. Then we have the next type, which is holmium YAG. Laser can also be used for benign prostatic hyperplasia and renal stones. So this is everything about the benign prostatic hyperplasia. Thank you for watching.